So, am I audible to you guys? Yes. So, hello guys. Let's crack ITJ in English. So, this is a new channel which is cracking JEE in English from Unacademy. So till now it's been only in Hindi, mostly in Hindi. So this is a channel exclusively in English for those of you who have trouble understanding Hindi. Okay, so that is the main point. Well, I'm here. I'm Srikant. So I'll be helping you in this channel. I'll be teaching physics. So before we start off, yes. Okay, it started again. Disturbance in audio quality. Yes. Okay, so is it clear now? Is it clear now, SIM24? Seems to be a problem. A moment. So before we go anywhere, I want you all to maintain social distancing, stay home and stay safe. Okay. That is the main motto I want you all to understand. Well, it's sounding fine for me. Okay, fine. Let's start off now. I think that sound is the issue is not there anymore. So okay. Yes. So I guess it is better now. I hope it is better at least. We have to start anyway now. Okay, so before we start off, I want you all to maintain social distancing. I know it is a hard time for every one of you, including me. But during this time where corona is everywhere, I want you all to stay home and maintain social distancing. Yeah, exam likhne ke liye, once you can go out, but otherwise, till we get a vaccine and all, stay home, stay safe, maintain social distancing, and wash your hands regularly. Okay, so. Hola guys, I am N. Srikant. I did my BTech from IIT Kharagpur with an AIR rank of 385. I've been guiding you guys, young minds like you guys, for the last 4 odd years. You guys only gave me a name, Human Calculator. I am a Sunrisers fan, and DC is equally marvelous. Like, DC is as good as Marvel, if not better. I'm a DC fan. So, if you have anything to say or anything to talk about in life, cricket, football, anything in life, about exams, well, I am here. Just drop it on the chat, hit the like button, hit the bell icon, and I am there to discuss with you. Okay. So let's crack IIT JEE on India's largest platform, Unacademy. So the point is, you have to get the plus subscription to access unlimited number of live and recorded courses from India's best educators from across the country at one single place. At a single place. So about the subscription, we'll discuss as we go. But it is very cool. Okay, the offers they provide are amazing. And as we also know, if you're good at something, you should not do it for free. So there is a nominal charge for it on each subject. So let's get tracking. So this is a special program I started for you guys who are writing JEE 2020 and also for 2021, because it's never too late to really understand how to solve problems. So this is a 15-day program, and that is why I call it Fortnight JEE Solutions. Okay. So today, as a part of it, we'll be doing JEE 2015 problems. Okay. So let's get started. As we know, I take 20 of the selected 40 odd questions from the paper, because we don't have time to do all the questions. That is why I'm going from back to front, because in the last 2 days we will cover more of the 2019 and 18. Okay. So I guess there is no issue with the sound now. Yes. So let's get starting. Let's get cracking. Okay, two spheres P and Q have equal radius. They have same radius. Have densities rho 1, rho 2 respectively. So both of them have densities rho 1 and as we know, since this liquid is on the, this ball is on the top, and it is connected by string which is looking very tight, it means that rho 1 will be less than rho 2, right? Rho 1 will be less than rho 2. That is the first inference we can get from here. The spheres are connected by massless string and placed in liquid L1 and L2 of densities rho 1 and rho 2 and viscosities eta 1 and eta 2 respectively. So they are placed in liquids of rho 1 and rho 2, and obviously here also we can say rho 1 is less than rho 2, because the liquid which is lighter will always stay on top. That is clear. And the viscosities are given as N1 and N2 respectively, eta 1 and eta 2. They float in equilibrium with a sphere P in L1 and Q in L2, the string being taut, which is already given. See figure. So P alone is in L2 has terminal velocity Vp, and Q alone in L1 has terminal velocity Vq there. So we have to solve this problem. Let us draw the diagram once again, just we can analyze it separately. Liquid 1 and this is liquid 2. Taking it 2. Ball 1 and ball. Both have equal radius, so they'll have same volume. That is one thing we can just take for common. The densities of these are given as rho 1 and rho 2. This is having density rho 1, this is having density rho 2. This is density sigma 1 and rho 2. And this liquid viscosity eta 1 and eta 2. Now, what do we know from this? The weight of fluid displaced should be equal to weight of the two bodies, right? Only then force of buoyancy should be equal to force of gravity. Only then will it be in equilibrium, right? Only then will the setup be in equilibrium. Getting it? So both of them should have same force. The force due to buoyancy, which is upward, should be same as force due to gravity, which is downward. So let's directly write it. Force due to buoyancy will be rho 1. So it's, first we'll do gravity. Okay. Let's write gravity first. Force due to gravity will be, on the upper block, it will be rho 1 V into G, and for the lower block it will be rho 2 into V into G, right? And similarly, force of buoyancy will be volume of fluid displaced into density into gravity, right? So in the upper liquid rho 1, on the upper liquid of density rho 1, volume V is displaced, so we will take rho 1 V G plus, in the lower liquid has density rho 2, so rho 2 V G is the lower liquid. So if these both are equal, from this what can we infer? It implies that rho 1 plus rho 2 will be equal to sigma 1 plus sigma 1. Taking Vg common and cancelling them out, this is what we will get, right? So from this, what can we say? That rho 1 minus sigma 1 is equal to, or we can also put it the other way, rho 2 minus sigma 2 is equal to rho 1, sigma 1 minus rho 1. one inference I want you all to understand. It's a very important thing because he's asking us about terminal velocities also. Now, one thing we know, rho 1 plus rho 2 is equal to sigma 1 plus sigma 2. And we know that rho 2 will, so for the string to be tight, the buoyant force on the upper block should be greater than the gravitational force. On the upper block on 1 should be greater than force due to gravity on 1. And force due to gravity on 2 should be greater than force due to buoyancy on 2. Only then the string will be taut, there will be tension extra, FB1 and force due to gravity 1. You observe, you're getting it right. The gravity on this upper block, the tension will be downward, force due to buoyancy will be up and gravity will be down. For this to be in equilibrium, we can say FB1 is equal to FG1 plus T. Or we can also say this equation, that force due to buoyancy 1 will be greater than force due to gravity 1. And similarly, in the opposite direction, if you take, tension is upwards, force due to gravity 2 will be here, force due to buoyancy on the second block will be here. So using that, we can say force due to gravity 2 is greater than buoyancy 2. Or we can see the equation, solve it, we'll get the same thing. Now, what do we know about terminal velocity now? Terminal velocity will always be in the direction in which the higher density body will give force. Like on block 2, on the lower block, the direction of terminal velocity will be lower because rho 2 is greater than sigma 2. On the upper block, you know, the terminal velocity will be upward because the buoyant force will always be more than gravitational force on the upper block. As a result, initially it will have net force upward, and finally due to the viscous force which is pulling it in the opposite direction. What does viscous force do? It opposes relative motion. Viscous force opposes relative motion. So what does it do? It does not want the liquid the ball to go up. So it will act downward and balance it. As a result, the terminal velocity will be upward because sigma 1 is greater than. And what do we know the formula of it? 2 r square into rho 2 minus sigma 2 by 9 eta into g. So in this case, this is for the second block, it will be by 9 eta 2, and for the first block it will be 2 r square into sigma 1 minus rho 1 into g by 9 eta 1. This direction is upwards and this direction is downwards. So now let's see, upper one is p, right? This is p and this is vq. From these both, what relation can we get? Vq by vp will be equal to eta 1 by eta 2, or vice versa, or vice versa. From this, we can also say Vp by Vq will be equal to eta 2 by eta, which is the option, right? Which is one of the options, which is second. We got the second option to be correct. Now, what is the other thing? The dot product of velocity of P and velocity of Q, terminal velocities. Now, we know both of them are in opposite direction, which means the angle between them is 180 degrees, right? When two vectors A vector dot B vector will be less than 0 when theta is greater than 90 degrees, and it will be greater than 0 when theta is less than 90 degrees. You know this logic, right? When dot product, when two vectors are along, they have same representation along a particular direction, then the dot product will be positive, which means they both should have less than 90 degrees between. When it's greater than 90, the dot product will be negative, and at 90 it will be 0. Hi Piyush. Hello guys. Hello. Yeah. So you got this concept, right? When the angle is greater than 0, when less than 90, the dot product will be positive. When the angle is greater than 90, the dot product will be negative. Now if you observe, on this we discussed the terminal velocity will be upward. On this the terminal velocity will be upward direction. On this the terminal velocity will be downwards. Right, so the angle between them is 180 degrees, so directly we can say the dot product will be less than 0, which is option D. The correct options are A and D. A, wait carefully. Vp by Vq is 4. Vp is inversely proportional to N. No, they are inversely proportional to each other, so it will be N1 by N2. My bad. To check the option, we will get from the equation we solved, we will get the same thing. From here, if you see, Vq will be proportional to 1 by N2. Getting it? So Vq, Yes, getting it? So from this we will get directly that it is equal to eta 2 by eta. Correct. Okay, next question. One or more than one option. So this is very important. One or more than one options, you have to be careful. You have to check every option possible. So that is where we should not be losing here. So both options we checked, we got right. Hence we could solve that. Now we go to the next question. In plotting stress versus strain curve for two materials P and Q, a student by mistake put strain on the y axis and stress on the x axis, as shown in the figure. Then the correct statements are. Well, one thing we know, how do we, when axis gets inverted from x to y and y to x, you simply draw the mirror image and that is it. Let's draw the mirror image first. Take a mirror at a particular angle like. Let's take the mirror to be like this. And from here, let's draw the mirror image of each of the bodies. It's that simple. It's a very simple technique. We use mirrors. Pretty cool. So for P, what will I do for P is, I will go a little downward like this. And anything down is up and then it goes like this. And what about Q? Q is on the above, which means it will be above this. And then it will stop. So this will be Q and this will be P. Now we have the other new image. It is the mirror image of the previous one, right? When X is Y, when X and Y become Y and X, how do you just put a mirror here about this point, about this axis. If you take a mirror, this will go this side and this will come this side. As a result, you will get Y and X. Getting it? Similarly, here also you want YX graph, so we can solve it here. So one thing we can see from the graph is that slope of P, now this becomes stress versus strain. Green is mirror. Green is mirror of X and Y. You're getting this point, right? So from this we can see that slope of Q is greater than slope of P, which means the Young's modulus of Q is greater than Young's modulus of P. That is the first inference we can directly see and solve, which is the option D here. It, you just, green is for mirror here, and if you see the mirror, you can see that slope of Q will be greater than slope of P. Getting it? And one more thing is, the more the strain, you can see from the graph also, you need not even mirror it, you can see that the strain in P is much greater, right? The strain in P is going till here, and the strain in Q is only till here, if you observe. So the strain in Q is much less than the strain in P, which means P will have more tensile strength, right? It can stretch longer, which means it has more tensile strength than Q. So option A and D will be correct. Oh, P is not, I directly wrote here that Young's modulus of Q is greater than P, right? So this is wrong. And we know the more stretching means more ductile. Getting the point, all of you? Yes, D is wrong. Yes, because we got here that Young's modulus of Q is greater than P. Here it is given as P is greater than Q. Getting it? Yes. And similarly, P has more tensile strength than Q. Tensile strength means it can stretch longer. And more ductile also means the same thing, because ductility is the ability of of a metal to become into thin and long wires, which is clearly when it has more strain. So using both of them, we can say A and B are the correct. Even without the graph, in fact, let me tell you something. You can also solve without mirroring. How? More Y means more strain. Got it? And slope here is 1 by Y. It is not Y. The slope in this graph is 1 by Y, because stress by strain is Y. So strain by stress is 1 by y, which is the slope of the given graph. You can use both of them and solve the answer also. Getting it? There are two ways. One is making mirror, the other is without mirror. You can use these both points. Clear? Okay. Now for the next question. A spherical body of radius r consists of fluid of constant density and is in equilibrium under its own gravity. So it is collapsing into itself because of its own gravity. If PR is the pressure at R, which is less than the total radius, then the correct options are. So this is one very important concept here. For this, we have to draw the concept of how pressure works. How pressure works. So, for simplicity, I am going to take the area of cross section to be unit. It can be a very small area, it can be big area, A is the area. But I am taking the area to be unit, unit area. Because to I can avoid, pressure is force by area, right? Pressure is force by area. Now, if I make area as 1, pressure will become force. They didn't ask me anything to take any standard division and find pressure. So, I am going to take the area of cross section to be 1 unit only, that's all. From this, I can directly write off, pressure will be equal to force from above. Okay. And the force will be equal to, generally force will be how much? Due to upper layers. We know force, in fact, we can forget this also. I'll tell you one thing, dP by dH is equal to rho into g. Remember this? This is one formula we derive in the beginning of calculating pressure. Pressure is rho gh you get. No, this is nothing but from here. dP by dH is rho g. When g is constant, you can directly send gh to the other side and you can start integrating with h, rho g as constant. But otherwise, if the gravity is varying, like we know in, due to earth also, the gravity will vary as we go up or down, right? Similarly, here also the gravitational force here will also vary. And since we know that the entire fluid is incompressible, is it given? It is fluid of constant density, which means it is not compressible. Understood? So, fluid of constant density means it is incompressible. The moment they say incompressible, it means that the density will be constant. One advantage we have. And we know about gravity with we know about the field. I'll just solve without any basic integration here, like without any extra formula. Okay, I'll only use this formula and how g varies, and based on that we'll solve it. Because I don't want to do full calculation. Why? Means everywhere it is ratios, right? The question is in ratios. Whenever there are ratios, I keep telling you there is no need of solving the entire formula. I am going to roughly solve the problem, roughly. Just like an example, we know how gravitational field varies with height, right, on the earth surface. It initially grows with a constant rate, and at this point where the earth reaches the edge, from here it falls down in a curve. So throughout this, it is linear function, right? It is linear. So with height, you can say with r, the gravity varies as what? G into x by r, where x is the distance from center and r is radius of earth. You understood the point here? As the height go, as we go out from the center of the earth, as we go like this as x, E will linearly vary with at the middle the field, the total field will be zero. As we go higher, the gravitational field will keep gradually increasing till it reaches the surface. This is the logic we will use. Okay. So, now we can simply take x to be going outside. We can also depict this by saying dP by dx is equal to rho into g into x by r. It is basically maximum on the surface and it is linearly increasing. So, what will I write as a function? I will simply use the unitary method and write x by r into g. That's as simple as it. Now I integrate it from the other side. Let me finish the equation. dP by dx is equal to rho into g into x by r. This is what we got, right? So I'll send dx to the other side. I'll get dP integration from 0 to p will be equal to rho g by r into x dx. Now when is the pressure 0? If you observe carefully, at the outermost surface, there is no pressure from outside, right? So at the outermost surface, the pressure will be 0. Pressure will be 0 at the outermost surface. And pressure will be Px at a distance x. So now we integrate it. P will become rho g by r into x dx. From, and if you know, actually, one thing I'll explain is, as the height keeps coming lower, the x value is decreasing, but the pressure is increasing. No. So here simply we can write minus. I explained this also in class. So as the height keeps decreasing from up to down, the pressure is increasing, which means both will have opposite effect. We will use the opposite effect here just for calculation simplicity. X dx is x square by 2. X square by 2 from 0 to from x to r. R to x. So pressure will become rho g into r square minus x square by r. So by taking this whole thing, instead of taking this whole thing also, I will write it in a simple format saying pressure is proportional to r square minus x square, pressure at a distance. So this statement is all I need because it's all ratios, right? I don't even require the exact value of rho, g, r on anything of this sort. This is just a big calculation. Instead of it, I can directly use density pressure will be proportional to r square minus x square. I'll just substitute values and I'll get the answer. Okay. Now at r is equal to 0, if I put pressure at 0, will be proportional to r square. No, it will be maximum. It will not be equal to 0. So first option is wrong. Second option, by 2r. Everything will be by 2r also is there. Yes, this is exact formula in fact. Correct. Rho g into r square minus x square by 2r. This is the exact formula. But I simplified it so that you can directly take it as proportional to r square minus x square. That is all we need. We don't need anything else more than that. Because if you see the values, it's all in ratios. Pressure at 3r by 4 by pressure 2r by 3. Pressure 3r by 5 by 2r by 5. Pressure at r by 2 by r by 3. All of these are ratios. We'll just start substituting one after the other. So in the first case, first option is not possible. Second option, at 3r by 4 by pressure at 2 by 3, right? Is that what is given? Yes. It should be equal to 1 minus 3 by 4 whole square by 1 minus 2 by 3 whole square. It's that simple. How much will this become? 1 minus 9 by 16 divided by 1 minus 4 by 9 is 7 by 16 divided by 5 by 9. Now send the whole thing to 63 by 80. Is this the option given? It is. So we are done. This option is correct. Option B is correct. Option B is correct. Now let's check for option C. 3r by 5 and 2r by 5. So it will be 1 minus 3 by 5 whole square by 1 minus 2 by 5. This is 16 by 25 divided by 21 by 25. Directly 16. Even that is correct. So options B, C are correct. What about R by 2 and R by 3? That doesn't sound right, no? It feels wrong. 1 minus 1 by 2 whole square by 1 minus 1 by 3 whole. This is 3 by 4 divided by 8 by 9. The whole thing to the other side, you get 27 by 30. It is not 20 by 27. So using these both, we'll get our options as B and C as correct. Cool. So this is the correct method. But then you can imagine it this way. Okay, imagine it this way, and you will get the right answer. Now for the next question, where you have a parallel plate capacitor having plates of area S and plate separation D. Plates area is S, total area is S, which means half of it is S by 2, and the other half is S by 2. And the total separation is d. So if you divide again that into half, the left half is d by 2, the right half is d by 2. The two different relative permittivities, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, this is 2 and this is 4, are introduced between the two plates as shown. This is 2 and this is 4 relative permittivity. The ratio of C2 by C1. Okay. Initially, what is C1? We'll just find out C1 here. Even general capacitance is epsilon naught A by D. It is epsilon naught A by D. Not epsilon naught, it's epsilon to A by D. So in the first case, epsilon naught is epsilon naught because there is only air in between whose permittivity is 1. So we'll directly write this into S by D. This is the first. In fact, we'll call it C naught. So C1 is given. So C1 is S by D. That is what we can counter. Now we have to find out the capacitance once the dielectrics are placed. Now once the dielectrics are placed, so I'll divide it into two parts. One part with area this is how the plate is. One with separation D, this is D. And this area is S by 2. In the other S by 2, there are two capacitors. Now, all the while, the permittivity of this is 2, and this is 4. Okay. Now, I will tell you one trick which is revolutionary. Okay, don't tell it to anyone. you just see the options and tell the answer, you will get it. Okay, most of it is covered with a dielectric constant 2, okay, and little part is with 4. So by logic we know that the dielectric constant should be greater than 2 and less than 4. This value is 1.2. This is a question which is extremely crazy. 1.2, this is 1.67, this is 1.4, and this is 2.33. Now by seeing this, what is the only option which is correct? There is no doubt in this at all. The foolproof method, this is exactly what I keep telling you guys. The moment you solve a problem like this without any effort, I didn't see this till right now when I'm teaching you live. I didn't see these options. I always solve the problem because it is the right thing to do. But in the exam, that is what I am trying to tell you. In the exam, things can work differently. You can just see the example and think. This option's value is 1.2. This option is 1.6. Option is 1.4. How do you know all this? This is gamma of monatomic gas. This is gamma of diatomic gas. So this way, even if you don't, if you are not good at calculations also, you can see and remember the values. And this is the only option which is greater than 2, hence the correct answer. You can smash it off that way. But I am explaining it also just in case the options were 7 by 3, 9 by 4, 11 by 5 and all, then it becomes tough to solve, right? So I will solve the problem. But in the exam, if you see options like this, do not leave the question. Just go for it. And you also know C1 by C2, C2 by C1 is only one possible answer. This is a one or more correct options question with only one correct answer. So this way, this is one way of optimizing your solution. Must hai na? Awesome. Okay, now we can solve it directly like this. This is one capacitance. This is one capacitance. And this is one capacitance. I will call this A, B and C. So, CB and CC are in series. And CA is in parallel with both of them, right? This is how the diagram is. So from this, if we find out individual capacitance, I can directly write C effective will be CA plus CBCC by CB plus CC by the same standard logic. When they are in series, the effective capacitance will be using parallel combination of resistance 1 by C equal to 1 by CB. And then this combination, these are in parallel, which means total capacitance will directly add off. Okay, so this is the final capacitance. We in fact wrote it off directly. I'm doing this quickly because I don't find the point in solving the whole thing again, because we already got the answer. It is D. You know the answer should be D. Okay, so let's solve it. CA will be how much? Epsilon A area A by EA. Right. So what is the epsilon of A? 2 into area of A is S by 2. By D. This directly I will get S by D. And CB will be equal to how much? CB will be epsilon A into epsilon B into area of B by separation of B, which is 2 into S by 2 by D by 2. 2S by D. Similarly, CC will be epsilon C AC by D, which is 4 into S by 2 by 4S by D. So effective equivalence of both of these will, we can just solve this off now. So C total will be equal to S by D plus 8 S square by D square divided by 6 S by D. S squared fire, what is your doubt? So that is S by D plus 4 by 3 S by D, which is 7 by 3. And S by D is also equal to the original capacitance, right? This is C1. So I will directly write C2 is equal to, yes, I am watching live squad fire, ask it out, shoot away. So C2 by C1 can be written as 7 by 3 is the answer given. There is a little delay, but you can ask your doubts. I will clarify it in some time, like maybe a minute or two is the option. So dekh, this is one, okay, yeah, ask it out now. So this is one method, like that's why I tell you, see the options possible. Hi Satish, okay, tell me. Okay. Okay, ask your doubt in general. So that is why I want you guys to start installing the app right away on Academy Plus, because there the interaction is more dynamic than here. Yeah, you're a 12th student. Okay. I have to do it quickly. I wasted my class 11 by sports. Sports. Array, it's never spoiling by sports. So that is why I'm telling you, you can also take a long term if you feel that you can do much better than what you are currently doing. So there are two kinds of things. One is if you have worked very hard for 2 years, and when you work very hard and you're not getting the marks, there is some students who will lose interest in it. So those students I won't recommend to take long term. Yeah, okay, that's it. Now you need to crack JEE 2020. That's all. So one thing is, if you are confident that you can do much better than what you did before, you go for it. Have a regular schedule, okay? Have a regular schedule. In fact, I am conducting a special class tomorrow for those guys. I will be conducting special classes for guys like you, where I will give you a master plan for how to crack 2020 and 21. Okay. Of course, you can crack it, man. Like, what is your percentile right now? If you are even above 80 or 70, your performance will increase many times if you work hard in the second year, in the 1 year extra. Getting it? Even if you get a very low percentile, you can crack it. But what I want you to do is have that confidence that you can do it and have a regular schedule. Yeah, we can have a deal. In fact, I'll talk to you about it. Listen to this channel if you are understanding the concepts. Subscribe to me here and I will tell you in the special classes in the Unacademy app and here about how to develop your writing exam skills. Okay. And I will also discuss about some topics where we will cover all the topics till 2021. I'll have a crash course till 2021 mains exams, where we'll cover all the topics. Okay. In fact, I will help you with that. So keep for that, you have to follow this, like this video and share it everywhere. Okay. Share, put it in your bell icon. Forget everything. Hit the bell icon so that you'll get regular feedback from this channel. Okay. Just see the questions. If you are able to understand this approach, you can do it. If you are not able to understand anything of what is happening here, yes, that is it. Good job, Satish. Go for it. Yeah, dekho. The point is, if you haven't even studied well till now, or those who are studying 11th class now, if you are understanding little of what is happening, like this question is first year ka question. So if you are able to understand the solution here, it means you are in the right track. All you need is to have a good timetable for what to do regularly, which I will be giving in the special classes. Where you will find them? Ante, you will find them in the Unacademy learning app. Okay. So all of you install that first. Okay. Subscriptions, I will tell you about how to subscribe and what are the advantages later. But I want you all to have a plan, like maintain a plan every day what you will be doing. That will really change everything. Okay. Especially Satish, for you I'm telling, those guys who want to take long term, have a set plan. Okay. Don't relax, don't over enjoy. That does not mean don't only sit and study. That is not a right method to do. Don't just sit and study the entire day. Study. That is why, in fact, I am taking class from 4 to 6 because we have football, cricket match from 7:30. No, Sunrisers match is there today. In fact, I would like you guys to enjoy yourself so that your brain remains healthy. You keep only studying. You know the saying, right? All study and no play make Jack a dull boy. That is what you should not be doing. Okay. Relax yourself, but don't make it out of proportion. That is where you need discipline, at least for preparation. Everything else is fine, but for preparing, you have to have disciplined preparation. Discipline is only plan, and plan is only smart work. Getting it? Hard work means sitting with a book for 12 hours with your mind somewhere else. Smart work is planning with discipline, study for 1.5 hours, take a break for half an hour, enjoy, play sports. Oh, that is very good. Then what is the problem? If you are playing national game, if you are playing at a national level, it is very good. Good job, Squadfire, Satish. Okay, now let's get back to this. We'll focus on this and finish this. Okay. It's totally fine. Go for it. Take a long-term coaching. In fact, apply my code NSS1. There's a code I'll give NSS1 on an Academy Plus. If you use this code, you will get additional off, and so you can take any offer. There are a lot of packages. We'll discuss about them as we go. Listen to this class first. Okay. There are some interesting questions, and slowly gather concept as you go. Okay. An ideal monoatomic gas is confined in a horizontal cylinder by spring-loaded piston. So this is a spring here. Spring force will be some kx type only. Okay. And this is area A. We'll just take something like that. Initially, the temperature and pressure are T1 and P1. Initial temperature and pressure are given, and the volume is also given. Now, if the spring is in its relaxed state, okay, there is no force initially, it's in a relaxed state. The gas is then heated very slowly to temperature T2. Slowly, heat is given to it, and the temperature finally becomes T2, and the pressure becomes P2, and the volume becomes V2. During this process, this thing comes out by x distance. Ignoring the friction between the piston and the cylinder. Okay. So now let's solve this problem. This is a little big, it's a little lengthy. So one thing we know, it's in relaxed state. Okay. The piston is moving x when the pressure becomes P1 to P2. The volume becomes V1 to V2 and the temperature becomes T1 to T2. Okay. So what is pressure? First, given all the conditions, we will find out energy stored in the spring. Energy stored in the spring will be how much? Energy stored in the spring is half K. Not much. It is just half K. Right. So, one thing we know. When heat Q is given to the system, there will be change in internal energy plus work done. Sum of these both will only be the heat given to the system. So, there is one question where heat supplied to the gas is given. One work done by gas is given, energy stored in the spring is given, and change in internal energy is given. Yes, force by area is pressure. Yes, correct. Now, energy stored in the spring is half kx square, right? So, by applying conservation of energy, some heat is given to the system. And what will happen? There is internal energy in the molecules which will increase, and also the extra energy which is remaining will be going as work done, right? Work done by gas. Now, how is gas doing work here? It is pushing the piston around, right? It is pushing the piston to the right, which means work done by gas is only equal to energy in spring. If you observe carefully, both of them are same. Getting it? Both of them are same. That is one crazy concept. Now, he gave many cases when one is V2 is 2V1 and T2 is 3T1. We will observe that case. V1 is V1. T1 is T1 and initial case is T1, T1 and T1. This is initial. And final, we don't know the pressure. We'll take it as P2, V2 and T2, right? And he says V2 is 2V1 and T2 is 3T1, which means temperature increased 3 times and the volume increased 2 times. Okay. Now we will apply this logic. So P2 into V2, which is 2V1, by T2, which is 3T1. What do we know about this law? Wait, I will not even write this. You know, PV is NRT, no? We will go from here only. And number of moles and R, are they changing for the gas? It is not changing. So, we can directly write PV by T is constant, which is equal to NR. I am not going to write much more than this. So, now I will write this for both the cases, case 1 and case 2. P1 V1 by T1 will be equal to P2 into V2, which is 2V1 by T1. Cancelling everything, P1 V1 are getting cancelled, T1 T1 are getting cancelled. From this, I will get P1 is equal to P2 into 2 by 3, or P2 is equal to 3P1 by. So, got it right? We know the pressure is 3P1 by 2. From here, we also got this. P2 is 3P1 by 2. Now, what is change from here? We'll directly solve off. What is the change in internal energy? And energy stored in the spring, we'll find. What is the energy stored in the spring? Energy stored is half kx square. Half kx square. Getting it? So, initially in free state, the pressure here and here will be P0, right? P0 is equal to P1 and here also P0. Actually, both will be P0. getting it. So initially both of them will have atmospheric pressure only. By applying this, you will get P2 is 3P0. Initially, this is like this. And finally, what will happen is, it moved by x, okay, and this it moved by x, and all this while the force here is kx like this, okay. And what is the extra force kx equal to? Kx will be, if you draw the free body diagram of the piston, let's draw the free body diagram of the piston. There is one kx force like this, given it moved by x, and then there is p0 into area here, and this is p2 into area. P2 is how much? 3p0 by 2. So applying both, we'll get kx plus p0 into a will be equal to 3p0 by 2 into a, or we'll simply get kx is equal to p0 a by 2. Just by doing simple calculation, we'll get kx is p0 into a by 2. This is what we got. So what is the work spring constant here? Spring constant is p0 into a by 2x. Got it. And one more thing, we know it is moving by x distance, and the volume is becoming 2 times, right? The volume became double when this block moved by x, which means from ax, it moved area into x is the increase in volume. If this is moving by x and this area is a, how much is the total volume? It will be area into x, right? So we can say 2v1 minus v1 is equal to area into x. Or directly we will get ax is equal to v1. This is one more equation. So ax is equal to v1 we got, and we also got the value of k. So what is the energy stored in the spring? So energy stored in the spring will be half kx square, which is equal to half into p0 a by 2x into x square, which is v1 square by a square. Not do it. X square will directly cancel this. From this, I will get p0 by 4 into ax, which is how much? Equal to v1, and similarly, this is equal to p1. So from this both, we will get p1 v1 by 4 as the answer. So first option is correct. 1 by 4 p1 v1 is correct. Getting it. Now one more thing, what is the change in internal energy? Change in internal energy is what? Directly change in internal energy is an easier formula. Just give me one moment. Increase the size so that you can solve in more. So this is the work done. So from this we can clearly see that energy stored in the spring is half kx square, which is the option correct. So option A is correct we got. Next thing about this 2V1 and 3T1 is the change in internal energy. What is change in internal energy? It's equal to F by 2 N R delta T, right? So he is given a monoatomic gas. So delta 2 will be 3 by 2. Number of degrees of freedom of a monoatomic gas is 3. Diatomic gas is 5. And polyatomic gas, which is not linear, is 6. Okay. So imagine it like single molecule, only rotation. X movement, Y movement, Z movement. There is no rotation, only X, Y and Z movement. So we'll have 3 degrees. When there are 2 bodies, there will also be rotation. And up, down, left. So there are 5. So that way we can analyze it. F by 2 into number of moles given is not given. It is NR delta T, no? Which can also be written as 3 by 2 times delta PV. So what is delta PV mean? 3 by 2 times delta PV means P2 V2 minus P1 V1. What is the P2 V2 case finally? Pressure into velocity is 3 P1 P0 by 2 into V1. Just call it P1 only. Minus. So by equating both, we will get 3 by 4 P1. P by 4 by 2 NR. Hey, why do you want to do so much here? Okay, wait, let me see. Don't do so much. Solve this again. What is the final temperature? That's all. Delta U is 3 by 2 into N into R into delta T is 2 T1, no? Simple. And what do we know? If this 2 and 2 are getting cancelled, we will get 3 NR T1. And what do you know? PV is nRT, no? So directly we'll get 3P1V1. The answer simple. Don't even think too much. 3P1V1 is the correct answer. Let me see what mistake we did. Volume is 2. So 2. There, no. Get cancelled. You'll get 3 by 2 times 2P1V1. Okay, that's it. You got the answer. From here also, you'll get 3P1V1. Got it? Simple calculation mistakes are acceptable right now, but I guess you have to work on it. Getting it. So this is one thing I want you all to know is silly mistakes are common for everyone in the entire country. There is no person in the country who does not do silly mistakes. Remember this. Stay chill. Don't worry about your silly mistakes. It's a very common thing. Understood. Next. Volume is V2 is 3V1 and T2 is 4T1. Based on that, we have to find the work done by the gas. Work done by the gas is, okay, let's solve it. What is the case? This is already done, no? So, okay. So what was asked here, if you observe carefully, the volume is 3V, it is 3 times. T2 is 3V1 and T2 is 4T1, which means pressure 2 will be, pressure is nRT by V, no? It will be in ratios, if you see, it will be just T by V. So directly 4 by 3 times T0. We can directly write it off like this. So what is work done? Work done will be half KX square. Same logic we will apply now. Work done is half KX square. X will be equal to, so KX is equal to extra force, no? P0, extra force is extra pressure. Extra pressure is 4 by 3 P0 into A. Force on the left side is 4 by 3 P0 into A. Minus P0 A. Same thing I'll draw and explain it. Just take this like this. From here it moved a little x distance. Means now the spring force will be Kx. There is also P0 into A like this. And there will be P2 into A. By using same equation again, we'll get Kx plus P0 into A is equal to P2 into A. So Kx is P2 minus P0 into A. That's it. So K will be P2 minus P0 is P0 by 3, right? 4 by 3 P0 and P0. Using those both, we will get this is equal to P0 by 3 into A. And the change in volume is A0 into X. Okay, that is only equal to 2V1. One thing we know. So this is this, and work done by the gas is equal to potential energy stored in the spring is equal to half KX. Might be a little lengthy. There are shorter methods for this. Just figure them out as you go. You have to figure multiple methods. Okay. Just if you have time, just relax and keep solving them. You'll get the answer. Half KX square will be how much? Half into P0 A by 3X to X square. P0 A by 6. P0 into AX by 6. What is the value of AX? 2V1. So you will get P0 into 2V1 by 6. P1V1 by 3. Done by the gas is potential energy stored this of KX. You know the change in volume, initially if it is V0, V1 and finally it is AV1, X, A0 into X will be equal to change in volume, 2V1. Let's look into this later. Next question is, we will come to this question tomorrow again, we will solve that. The figure below depicts two situations in which two infinitely long static line charges and constant positive line charge density lambda are kept in parallel. Okay, they are kept in parallel to each other in resulting electric field. Now, one thing we know, when there are positive line charges, infinite length, the field will be outward, right? Positive charge density means the field will be outward. Negative charge density means the field will be inward. So here the field will be outward like this. Similarly, here also field will be outward. Like this. Getting it? So ultimately, at this point, here the field due to this side will be more, this side will be less. So ultimately, it will be like this. And at this, along this line, the field will become zero because field is a vector. And from this side and this side, both of them are equal and opposite as they move here. As they reach this area, the field due to both of them will become same and equal and opposite direction. So sum of two vectors which are equal and opposite is a null vector, right? So along this line, the field will be zero. But if you go little to this side, the field will be like this. A little to this side, the field will be in this direction. That is what we know. So if charge plus Q is placed little to the left, if it shifts, the net field will be towards the center again, right? The net field will be towards the center again. As a result, the force observed will be back to the center. So it's like if you put a ball in a big bowl like this, push it a little from the centermost point, it will come back to its original point because the force will be towards the center. Similarly, here also, little displacements to the left or to the right will make it, make the body experience an opposite direction force. F observed will be in opposite direction. So from this, by logic, we can say, simply, like charges repel, no? So this lambda charge here and lambda charge here will repel the Q charge. Little to the left, it will come back again. Little to the right, it will come back again. Getting it? So in the X plane, Q will be undergoing SHM. Because little change, and generally if it is coming back to its original position, when a little change is happening, 90% of the cases, it will be in SHM. Understood? 99% of the questions. Because when X is very small, the higher powers will generally be ignored. And eventually, force will be function of X. Getting it? So, and if you take minus Q here, little if it moves to the left, little if it moves to the left, what will happen? The field is in this direction here. And the charge is negative, which means the force will be opposite to the direction of field. Getting my point? This is the direction of field here. This is the direction of field here. At this point, the force will be in the opposite direction because Q is negative. Getting it? Because Q is negative, the force will be in the opposite direction, and little movement to the X, and that's what it will start getting attracted to the Y. Little to the right also, it will start getting attracted to the right, even if it moves here, the observed force. Simple, little to the left, the force between this wire, the closer wire and this, you know this, no? The farther the both the charges are, the lesser the force will be. So if it goes little to the right side, the force between the right side line charge and the minus Q point charge will increase. Since that force is attractive in nature, it will start attracting further. So plus Q observes simple harmonic motion while minus Q continues to move in the direction of this, which is absolutely correct. The option is understood. Next, two independent harmonic oscillators of equal mass are oscillating about its origin with angular frequencies omega. Total energies of E1 and E2. Energy here is E1, energy here. The variations of momentum P are given with X. Now, what is angular momentum? What is momentum here? P is nothing but M into V. It is undergoing, these are harmonic oscillators, no? So, we can say V will be equal to omega into root A square minus X square or something like that. Remember this from SHM. But I won't write this whole thing because I know maximum value of P and maximum value of X. Maximum value of P and maximum value of X. You know, maximum velocity will be omega into A, right? We'll use the same formula here. Understood? Because we also have omegas. With angular frequencies, omega 1 and omega 2 have energies E1 and E2 respectively. The variation of their momentum with position X. Two independent harmonic oscillators are moving like this. The variation of their momentum P with positions X are shown in the figures. A by B is given as N square. And a by R is given as N. And one thing we know is the maximum angle, maximum momentum is B. And the maximum displacement is A. Similarly here, the maximum displacement is R. And the maximum momentum is also R. Because it's a circle. So directly we'll apply that formula. In case one, in any case, we know V max is equal to omega into amplitude. So we can also say P max will be equal to m into omega into amplitude. That is one way of solving it. So now we'll apply this in both the cases. P1 will be equal to m into omega 1 into P max basically. P max will be equal to m into omega into A. So what is the A for this? A. M into omega 1 into A will be equal to B, right? Because maximum momentum is how much? B. And maximum amplitude is A. By using both of them, we can write, what can we write? Omega 1 will be equal to B by A into. So what are the options given? Omega 1 by omega 2. Okay. We'll find omega 1 and omega 2. We'll solve some. So this is B by A into. What is B by A equal to 1 by n square? No? 1 by m into n square. So for the second body, for the second body, what can we say? P maximum is equal to m into omega 2 into A, right? And what is P maximum here? It is equal to R. It's very simple. R is equal to m into omega 2 into R. So from this, we'll get R and R getting cancelled. Directly, omega 2 will be equal to omega 1 by n. So from this, omega 2 by omega 1 will be how much? 1 by m by 1 by m n square equal to. So option B is correct. Okay, that is one thing we know for sure. Next, we have to find something between energy and omega. What is energy of any oscillator? It is half m omega square a square. No, directly I'll substitute this in E1 and D2. E1 will be equal to half into m into omega 1 square into a square. Now one thing we know, omega 1 into a, if you observe, omega 1 into A will be equal to B by M, right? That only I'll put. Half into M into omega A whole square, omega square A square into omega 1 into A whole square, which will become B square by M. Right? And similarly, E2 will be equal to half into M into omega 2 square into A 2 square, which is equal to half into M into 1 by M square into R square, which is R square by 2A. So from this, what will get? E2 by E1 or E1 by 2? What is he asking? E1 by E2 is equal to B square by 2M by R square by 2M, which is equal to B square by R square. So what was B square by R square given? A by R is given as N, no? A by R is equal to N and A by B is equal to N square. From these both, if you divide both of them, what will you get? B by R is equal to 1 by N. Getting it? So B square by R square, E1 by E2 will be equal to 1 by N square, which is also equal to how much? Omega 1 by. From this directly, we will get an inference. E1 by E2 is equal to omega 1 by omega 2, or E1 by omega 1 is equal to. So just keep playing around with all the equations you get. From this, you will get the answer. So options should be B and D, which is correct. Understood? Okay. Now, what questions? We have to do little. We have to speed up a little this process. So any doubts you have, feel free to put it on the chat. Okay. Sim24, Squadfire. And Piyush, all you guys, okay. Just feel free to put in your chat, so I'll read them. It's okay. Two identical glass rods S1 and S2 have refractive index 1.5. So the refractive index of both of them are 1.5 and 1.5, same material. They are placed on a curved surface at a distance d, as shown in the figure, with their axis aligned. And point source of light P is inside is placed. One thing we know here is the radius of curvature. Okay, this is very important. You know the radius of curvature is how much? 10 centimeters, which is some value. Easy to calculate for sure. Okay. Now, S1 is on when a point source of light P is placed inside rod S1. The point source is placed here at a distance 50 centimeters from the curved surface. Light rays are emanating from it around to be found parallel on the inside of S2. Now, one thing we know, they form their parallel light rays, which are going out from here like this, or whatever way they are going out, they'll end up becoming parallel to the principal axis. They'll become like this at the end. Pretty cool, right? They're becoming like this at the end. So how will they behave? One method is like this. This is the only way they will behave. Okay. Because we know this lens's light rays bend towards the normal. No? So if it is going straight like this, it will bend away from the normal, so it will go outside. So this is the best method of getting the answer. So what are the two ways now? One thing we can understand is there is one image formed here, I1, which will also behave as object 2. Getting it? So this will be for this interface, this will be the image distance, and this will also be the object distance for the second one. Getting it? The light ray which is going from here, this is the original object. This is O dash. Original object will go like this, and it will intersect on the principal axis at O dash, and this will behave like the object for the second one. This is also equal to I. Image will behave like the object for the second diffraction. So we can apply the Lensmaker's formula two times to get the answer. Okay, what is the Lensmaker's formula we remember? Okay, mu 2 by v minus mu 1 by u is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 by r. This is a simple Lensmaker's formula. Directly we'll apply this, we'll get the answer. Okay, so we'll just apply it. Initially, the object is in air, right? Which means it will become 1 by v minus 1.5 by 50 is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 is 1 minus, one thing we know, this 50 is behind, right? So we have to put minus 50. Will be equal to mu 2, which is 1 minus 1.5 by radius of curvature, which is inward, which means light ray is going from left to right, which means the radius of curvature will also be negative, right? We get 1 by v is equal to 1 by 20 minus 1.5 by 50 is equal to 5 minus, we'll directly get v is equal to 50 centimeters. So the first image we got, this value is 50 centimeters. So the answer should be greater than 50. That is one thing we know for sure. Now we'll use the other thing, other way. So in the second half, the interaction is like this. Light rays will come like this and will emerge parallel in this medium. Getting it? So initially this will be the object distance and the image distance will be infinity. Again we'll apply the Lens formula. Mu 2 by v minus mu 1 by u is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 by r. Apply the same thing. So mu 2 is 1.5 by infinity minus 1 by u is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 by, and if you observe carefully, the radius of curvature here is along the direction of light rays traveling. So it will be positive 10. From this directly I get minus 1 by u is equal to 1 by 20, or u is equal to minus 20. Minus 20 means it is backward at 20. Got it? So we got v is equal to 50 centimeters and u is equal to 20 centimeters. And with the separation is v plus u, which is equal to a simple straightforward question. It's just basically applying Lensmaker's formula twice. Like Lensmaker's formula. This is the only formula which you need for most of problems in optics. Most any contact, any lenses problem, you can only use this formula and solve. Lensmaker's very key. It is mu 2 by v minus mu 1 by u is equal to 2 minus at every surface. You can derive all these 1 by v minus 1 by u is equal to 1 by r, all these formulas from this Lensmaker's formula. Option is B, which is 70. Now, a container of fixed volume has a mixture of 1 mole of hydrogen and 1 mole of helium. There are 2 moles, one is hydrogen and the other is helium, in equilibrium at temperature T. Assume that the gases are ideal, the correct statement is. The average energy, what is the energy? Energy is F by 2 nRT, no? We'll just average energy means F by 2 RT. Average means per mole. The average will be F by 2 RT. What is F of mixture? f of mixture is f1 plus n1 f1 plus n2 f2 n1 plus n2 by n1 plus n. Now what is degrees of freedom of hydrogen? Hydrogen is diatomic, which means it will have 5 degrees of freedom into 1 plus another thing is helium, which has 1 degree of freedom into 1 by 2, 1 plus 1. From this you will get average of f of the mixture is 4. Got it. So E average will be how much? E average will be, so from these both we can directly write E average is equal to 4 by 2 into RT, which is 2 RT. Correct. First option A is correct. Ratio of speed of sound in the gas mixture to that of the helium gas. Now what do we know about speed of sounds? What do you know about speed of sound in a mixture? It is generally equal to root gamma RT by M. You have to remember this. Root 3 RT by M is RMS speed. Root 8 by pi is average speed. And root 2 RT by M is most probable speed. You know all this. Similarly, root gamma RT by M is speed of sound. Okay, this is derived by Newton. This is a little lengthy derivation for it, which will not be doing right now. Not even required. You can just remember this. Gamma RT by M. And now, for gamma of helium, so for ratio, he is asking us ratio of speeds. If you observe, R and T are same for both of them. So from this directly you can write off that speed of sound in the mixture. Speed in mixture by speed in helium, helium only, no, he is asking, is equal to root gamma mixture by M mixture divided by root gamma helium by mass of helium. You're getting it? This is a standard way of solving it. And how do you find gamma of mixture? It is nothing but 1 plus 2 by f of mixture. Gamma is 1 plus 2 by f. So in this case, gamma will be how much? 1 plus 2 by 4, which is 1.5. And what is the average molecular mass of the mixture? It is 1 into hydrogen's molecular mass is 2 plus 1 into helium's molecular mass is 4 by 2, which so we'll substitute both of them here. Think both. V mixture by V of helium will be root 1.5 by 3 divided by gamma of helium is how much? 5 by 3, right? It's 1.67 gamma of helium, yes. So it will be 5 by 3 by 4. That is nothing but 1 by 2 into 4 into 3 by 5. Yeah, that's it. This is coming out to be 12 by 5 or 6 by 5, root 6 by 5. Which is the correct answer. Understood. The ratio of RMS, so this option B is also correct. We also got A correct and B correct. Now, the ratio of RMS speed of helium atoms to that of hydrogen atom. What is RMS speed? It's directly root 3 RT by M, no? This is what we just told you. So, VRMS is directly proportional to 1 by root of molecular mass. Everything else is same for both. 3 is same for both gases, of course. R is same, it's universal gas constant, temperature is same. Using this directly, VRMS will be proportional to 1 by molecular mass. So, helium to hydrogen is asking. Helium to velocity of hydrogen will be equal to 1 by root of mass of helium into root of, like, basically divided by 1 by root of 2. Or simply, you can say root 2 by root 4. It's very simple. Velocity of helium, you know one thing for sure. Velocity of helium, or simply I'll tell of why. Not even write this out. Will be proportional to 1 by mass of helium into mass of helium, mass of hydrogen. Because it's inversely proportional, you can say this. Directly I'll substitute the values, it will be root 2 by 4, which is. So if option D is correct, C is wrong. So the options are A, B, and D. Okay. So this is the end of multiple choice questions. Now we will have integer problems. So this is like one half of the paper done. You know it's a little lengthy today, but it's okay. We'll do as many as possible. So one thing is, Unacademy is India's largest learning platform, which is made especially for students like you in this kind of times when there is a very it's not possible to go to school and all. If you want to really study well, Unacademy is the best place to be for learning online. Okay. Take the plus subscription and you will get crazy amounts of benefits. What are those means? One is daily live classes. Okay, live classes means not just live class like here. It will have dynamic doubt plays and dynamic quiz session. Like whenever any question I ask, you'll be having a poll beside you on the app. You can click on the poll and answer directly instead of typing it on the live chat. Similarly, any doubt you have, if you type it, I can directly see it while teaching. I'll be teaching the class there and I can see your doubts popping up there directly instead of seeing a separate channel. And moreover, it will be live. It will not be delayed. So it will happen very dynamically, where it will be very easy for you to ask doubts. Even those students who don't ask doubts in school also, when teachers are explaining, those who are shy, you can just type in your doubts. You can get your doubts clarified very nicely. So it is one very big advantage. This is bringing school closer to you than ever before. Okay. Not even, I remember even in school, a lot of students don't ask doubts because they are little shy. But here they are asked, free to ask, because it is typing. And this is one very big advantage. And then one more thing is live tests and quizzes, which I always tell you is important. I keep telling this to you, I can't stress more. But one thing I want you to understand is, instead of solving questions like one after the other, you have to solve problems in terms of tests and quizzes. That is the best way to approach. Okay, every set of questions you do, make it a quiz or a test. And Unacademy has lots of quizzes and tests live in the app. And there is also a structured course. All our courses are in line, where everything is divided. Like you have Pura chapter content, you have problems, and you have JEE problems, all of them divided in a very structured manner. And you have unlimited access, not only just with one subscription, you get teachers from all the country, from across the country, some from North India, some from South India. Everyone whom you are comfortable with will be there, including me. So feel free and go for it. First, install the Unacademy Learning app. I will be giving special classes coming in this week. From tomorrow or day after tomorrow, it will be majorly based on how your lifestyle should be and what you should do. It will not be about physics to start. I want you all to understand and develop a disciplined lifestyle which will help you get there. So I will give you certain tricks like that in the special class. So install the app right away and log into that. And one more thing, yes, this is for people like Satish. There are special offers in JEE subscription. This subscription is 7,000 for a month. Okay. But 1 month there is no use right now, because JEE Advanced gets over within 15 days. And after that, it's all about writing for next year, right? So for next year, if you want to take, I advise you to take this plan. Why? Because if you take for 3 months or 6 months, it will not be sufficient to cover the entire year. At the end of the year, you might miss out. Like if you take the subscription now, it will be over by January or February, the 6 month one. Over with February, and you will lose all the benefits. And then if you want to get back again, if you want to subscribe again, it will become 28,000 extra or 20,000 extra. But if you use 12 months directly, the sum of these both also is greater than this. If you observe, this plus this is greater than this, but the total sum 9 months is less than 1 year. You're getting the main reason I keep stressing on this. It is because it is cheaper on a long-term basis. The longer you take it, the cheaper it is. This is especially for 2021 guys and long-term guys and droppers. So for you guys, this is the best plan. Hurry up and take it. And not only this, if you take my code NSS1, you will get an additional 10% off. 38,500 may 10% off is 3,850. You subtract that, you get 34,650 per year. So you might think this number is looking big. No, it might look big. But again, I'll say again, I believe in Joker Baba. Joker said, if you're good at something, never do it for free. And I think Unacademy is doing an extraordinary job. That is why they will have to charge a nominal fee. This might look large, but let me explain it to you. You have physics, chemistry, maths. Okay. So it is coming out to 2,888 per month. So each of the subject, if you check carefully, it is like less than under 1K. Value is less than 1K for every one of them. It is coming out to be close to 970 rupees. Hey Joker Baba, yes, 970 rupees per month on each subject. So even if you take a tuition, it will be more than 2K or 3K per month, right? So that is the main thing. It might look big, but I am telling you all, this is a very nominal fees. And hurry up, use this code NSS1 to get additional 10% off. You get it for, this is like how much, 30 rupees per subject per day. Even if you do 10 problems or listen to one of my classes like this or any class like this every day, that will be easily more than 30 rupees. So per subject, it's costing 30 rupees. So, kya milega 30? So, I sincerely feel it is a very good offer. So, even if you want, if you feel this is a big number, you will also have EMI schemes. So, just go for it. 2021, guys, you have to go. You should not be waiting anymore. That's it. Okay. So, that's about it. Remember the code NSS1 and let's go to the next question. Single digit integer. Now we have integer questions where guessing is a little tough. I know, but I'll tell you ways if I find any. Okay. So the E energy as a function of time is given by A square into E power minus alpha T, where alpha is this one. The measurement of A has an error of 1.25% and the measurement of error in time is 1.25. The percentage error in the value of ET. The percentage error. Now one thing we have to do, before I explain anything else, let me, we'll just do the log function of it. You know, E is a function of T. This is the standard way of solving it, okay. E power minus alpha. The standard way of solving it is by dividing, breaking this into log. So we'll get ln E is equal to 2 ln A plus minus alpha T. Right. This is the simple method, 2 ln A minus alpha T. Now you differentiate this with respect to E. Now differentiating this, what will we get? Now if I differentiate this, I get delta E by E, dE by E is equal to 2 times dA by A minus alpha T. Since this is about error, if you observe carefully, if error can be acting in both ways, right, plus and minus. So one thing we know is error formula delta E by E, now directly we can write it off, will be equal to 2 times delta A by A plus alpha T. This is how it is. Like, because this is minus here, now this is only differential equation, not error. Error, now let me explain why this is, you are adding here and not adding here. I did this yesterday also. Suppose there is 100 by some value x. X is equal to 10. Okay, and it has an error of plus or minus 1. Okay, this can be plus or minus 1. So, if you take error here, if it is plus 1 here, just as if it is in denominator, does not mean this will only become plus, no. So, even if this becomes minus, the value will keep increasing. 200 by 11. So it can both increase and decrease because of the lower degree, getting it? Even if the denominator has error, numerator where the whole value will also increase in error, right? Any error in denominator will add to the error overall. So this is the point, I write it down. Any error in denominator will add to total error. So this is the main thing you have to remember or understand, because error does not behave like calculations. Error behaves like, will it, if it affects one place, it will affect the whole thing. Like the effect at the denominator will be same as effect in the numerator, because error in denominator will be error in the overall solution. Getting my point? So error is something which is deviation from mean position. Just think about it this way. Deviation from the exact position. If denominator deviates, the value also deviates. So denominator may there is error, the whole error also will increase. That is why instead of minus, we will end up taking plus. Now what are the errors given? 2 into delta A by A is nothing but percentage error of this into 1.25 plus alpha value is 0.2 into time value is 5. 1.5, right? Into 1.5. So adding both of them, we will get 2.5 plus alpha is 0.2 and time error is 1.5 and the value of time is into delta t by t, of course, should be there. So value of time is 5 seconds and the value of delta t is 1.5. So you're adding the whole thing, you get 1.5 plus 5, which is all the same person. Getting it? So this is how we solve it. Simple. Due to error due to a double, it will become double, and error due to time, it will become alpha into t into error in time. That's all, which is 4. No, for single digit integer, next question. For a radioactive material, its radioactivity is a, and rate of change of its activity is r. R is dA by dt as defined. So nt is the number of nuclei at time t. Okay, n as a function of time. Two radioactive sources p and q, both having half times here, have same activity at t is equal to 0. So same activity, they have same activity. A1 will be equal to, that is the first equation, and half life of p is equal to tau. T half of p is equal to tau, and t half of q is equal to double. So the ratio of disintegration is half for q. So logically, if they both have same activity, we know for sure that the number of molecules of q will be greater than number of molecules of p. Got it? Okay. Now he is asking us the rates of change in activity at t is equal to 2 tau. At equal to 2 tau, the rate of change in activity is Rp by Rq. Okay. So let's solve this question. To understand this best, we know everything is exponential, right? So we can directly at any point A will be the number of moles. Will be equal to n naught into e power minus t by tau. Getting it? So from this directly we will get a will be equal to n naught into 1 by tau to e power minus t by tau. Okay. So in fact, wait, let me just solve this. Let's just take the whole thing. Initially a1 and a2 are given, no, they are given to be equal. So we know one thing, we know a is an exponential function. I'll tell it this way. A is an exponential function like this. So then dA by dt will be equal to some kt, no, by using the same logic. Or simply I'll say a will be equal to a naught into e power minus t by tau. A naught is the initial activity into minus t by tau. So from this directly dA by dt will be equal to minus a naught by tau into e power minus t by tau. Getting it? So this is for the first case, which is for p. You only know p. So for dA for p will be equal to a naught by tau into this. Similarly, minus dA q by dt will be equal to a naught into e power minus t by 2 tau by dt, which is coming out to be how much? A naught into minus 1 by 2 tau into e power minus t. So just equating both of them, let me solve this in a little lengthy way. I want you all to understand it slowly. For this, let me solve it in this blank paper. One thing. So each one has P and Q, right? Initially, both of them have same A. A1 is equal to A2 is equal. Now one thing we know, A is, A will be equal to, at any time will be equal to A naught into e power minus t by tau, minus t by t half. This is the standard formula. Okay. Now let's solve this for both the bodies. At t is equal to 2 tau, AT, A1 will be how much? A1 final. Call this AP. P will be A naught into minus 2 tau by tau. This is nothing but A naught by E square. And AQ will become how much? a naught into e power minus 2 tau by 2 tau. You're getting the point, no? Everywhere a naught, a will keep changing. A naught by e. So we know the values of ap and aq. Now we have to find values of rp and rq. Rp is equal to a. At any point it is dA by dt, no? That is a naught by, for rp, a naught by e square into d e power minus t by tau by d tau equal to e half minus. So directly we will get a naught by e square into tau into e power minus. Getting it. And for RQ, it will be dA by dt will be equal to A naught by E into e power minus theta by dt equal to A naught by E into 1 by 2 tau. Here it is 2 tau, no? Into e power minus by A naught by 2 tau, 2 into by linking both of them, we will get the value as e cube by e square will also be there. So, by linking both of them, we will get rp by rq will be equal to a naught by e power 4 divided by a naught by 2 e cube. This directly will get 2 by e, which is equal to n by e here. Substituting value, will get the value to be 2. Getting it? So it is little lengthy here, but if there is a simpler way, let me explain it to you. Okay, I'll explain it without solving this also. Alternate method. I like telling alternate methods. For a given radioactivity, we know differentiation will be proportional to d by dt. Will be proportional to the exponential may whatever k value is there. So if it is disintegrating faster, the one which has lower half life will disintegrate faster. Got it? At t is equal to 2 tau, that is why we will get that at t is equal to 2 tau we will get that the value of ap will be the number of moles which are left for active integration will be half of. And if you differentiate, it will be 1 by e times, 1 by e times. In fact, for every for every half-life time, the amount of quantity will keep becoming 1 by e. Getting it? Mean life, not half-life. For every mean lifetime, the value will be keep reducing to 1 by e. Understood? So, now finally, we know AP by AQ is this much. And we also know RP by RQ will be 2 because the mean life is double, and when you are differentiating e power minus kt, it will become a multiplication factor of k into e power minus kt. So k for p is double of q. K of p is equal to 2 times k of, using these both directly I can multiply of into ap by aq, which will directly be 2 by e. Getting my point? So this way, with simple method also you can solve it, you will directly get 2 by e, or you can each differentiate the whole thing, you will get the same answer. Understood? So do this once again and then you will get the answer. It's easy to check. The four harmonic waves of equal frequencies and intensities have phase angles. One is at 0, one is pi by 3, 2 pi by 3, the other is pi. We have to add all the four of them. All of them are superimposed. The intensity of the resulting wave is n I naught, value of n. Now one thing we know, what is the intensity of combination of two waves will be root I1. Plus root I2 root amplitude I1 plus I2 plus 2 under root I1 I2 into cos theta. Remember, this is the resultant amplitude. So what I'll do is simple method. I'll take any two of them, add, I'll take other two of them, add, then I'll add both of them separately. Getting it? I'll take two of them, add it, then I take another two of them, add it, and then I'll find both of them separately. So there are two methods of doing it. One is you take 0 and pi by 3 and 2 pi by 3 and pi. Then add both of them separately. But the smarter method is taking 0 and pi together and these both together. These both as one unit, these both as one. Why am I taking this? Because when they have a phase difference of pi, one is at 0, other is pi, means both of them have exactly opposite phase difference. That time this cos theta becomes cos pi is equal to minus 1. Which means they both destructively interfere and both of them will cancel each other. So for this and this, I of 0 plus I of pi will be equal to I plus 2 into I into cos pi, which is equal to 0. Getting it? That is why I use 0 and pi. So for I of pi by 3 and 2 pi by 3, I can calculate them separately. What is the phase difference between pi and 2 pi by 3 and 2 pi by 3? It will be pi by 3 only, right? The difference between pi by 3 and 2 pi by 3. Hence, 2i into cos pi by 3. Cos pi by 3 is cos 60, which is equal to 1 by 2. The value of n is 3. Getting it? So it is, again, this is also a little simple only. Oh, now for wonderful. This I liked explaining this because this has a lot of symmetries involved. All these resistance questions, especially with these kind of questions, you have to catch the right kind of symmetry. Understood? Now, one thing we know, everything in this here following resistance through the 2 amperes is asking us to find this I. So, it is nothing but the I flowing through the wire, right? So, I flowing through the voltmeter. So, you need not even find individual currents. You can just find R effective, you will get the answer. You have to just find R effective here. It's pretty simple. Why? So, the general trick I use is find places where there are exclusive set of resistances. Like if you observe carefully from in this set, there is this exclusive set of resistances from this point to this point. So we will find out the effective resistance of this part first and we can gradually bring it down to the whole thing. If you observe carefully, this by this is equal to this by this. What is the condition for Wheatstone bridge? R1 by R2 should be equal to R3 by R4. Even R1, R2, R3, R4 are like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. So basically, up, down, or left, right, either these both or these both should be the same ratio as the other. Then the Beechmere resistance can become nullified. You know that thing, right? So we'll do that here. Is it possible 1 by 2 and 2 by 4, which means they both are in Wheatstone bridge. So now what can I do? I can simply remove the 8 ohms off. This can directly be removed. And now what do you know? These both will, 1 and 2 ohms will be in series, 2 and 4 will be in series, and this and this together will be in parallel. So let me draw a diagram which will show that correctly. So this kind of questions are very useful because they will eventually help you analyze how Wheatstone bridge is, how to solve problems using Wheatstone. Now what I did is I removed the 8 ohms off. This 8 ohms I removed. So what am I left with? 1, 2, 2 and 4. Which means this is 3 ohms and this is 6 ohms. And they both are in parallel. So 1 by 3 plus 1 by 6 will be equal to 1 by 2 by logic. So sum of these both will become 2 ohms. So this whole thing will end up becoming like this. Two, six, 12, 4. Again, if you observe, this is how the circuit becomes. Again, if you observe, 2 by 6 is equal to 4 by 12. So this is also gone now. So from this another Wheatstone bridge I'll apply and I'll get this directly. This 2 ohms and 6 followed by 12 and on the other side it is 2 followed by 4. which means these both are in series now and these both are in series. This is 6 and 18. 6 and 18 in parallel. How do I solve that? 1 by 6 plus 1 by 18, which is coming out to be 4 by 18. So R effective will here be equal to 18 by 4, 4.5. So I can simplify the entire thing. From here I can simplify it by saying this is a volt of 6.5 volts. Then there is a 2 ohm resistance followed by the entire effective resistance to be 4.5 ohms. So directly R effective is 6.5. V is 6.5. So I will be 1 amp. Getting it? So this way, just applying one Wheatstone bridge, always draw it in a shape which you are comfortable. Like if you want, draw it in triangle shapes, or you make them into rectangle shapes like here. Either ways, make them into shapes where you are able to understand Wheatstone bridge properly. Most of the times it will be like this only. This is the best way to understand it. So 2 and 6, 4 and 12 will be in Wheatstone bridge. They are in this equilibrium type situation. Getting it? Just like we saw here, this the 1 and 2, 2 and 4 in the original question. These both and these both. Later we are using this whole setup with the next set. Got it? So this is a good question to generally analyze your calculations. So if you want to generally analyze your, if you want to take break from solving problems, another good method is finding equivalent resistances. Just take some simple problems, keep doing them again, like H.C. Verma or any book will do. Keep doing the same problem again. When your mind feels like you want to solve something, solve these. This will help your brain relax. Okay, next. This question, I won't use any method except for the one single formula we know. Everything else is direct. Okay. So electron is in an excited state. Lithium 2 plus ion has an angular momentum of 3h by 2 pi. You know the angular momentum is generally defined by nh by 2 pi, where n is the orbit, which is equal to Li for Li 2 plus, which is given as 3h by 2 pi. So from this directly we will get n is equal to, got it? So wavelength of the electron in this state, given A naught is the Bohr's radius. For the Bohr's radius, what is the actual value of length? Then we can also already define A naught will be equal to Rz by n square. So, or we can also write will be equal to A naught into n square by z. This is the general radius ka definition. So we'll substitute the values. We know the value of n, we know the value of z. Z is atomic number, excuse me, which is 3 for lithium. Hydrogen, helium, lithium, which is 3. And n is equal to 3, already we derived. So apply both of them, we will get R is equal to A naught into 3 square by 3, which is 3 naught. Okay, this is the radius of orbiting. Okay, and one more thing we know, as angular momentum of 3 h pi, which means that the lambda will be equal to, it is making 3 rotations, right? Lambda will be equal to 2 pi r by n. So from this also we will get 2 pi into r by, substitute the value of r is 3 a naught here, which will be equal to 2 pi into 3 a naught by 3. So what is the wavelength here? So wavelength is this simple, it is rotating 3 times, it is having 3, which means it is n will be 3. Getting it? So for 2 pi r radius, there will be n number of waves, which means wavelength will be 2/3 of it. It's a very straightforward question, which is 2. Now for another single, this is another decent question where we'll directly use work energy theorem. By seeing this only you can understand. Two identical uniform discs are rolling without slipping on two different surfaces A, B and C. Starting at A and C with linear speeds V1 and V2 respectively, and always remain in contact with the surface. They are always remaining in contact and they are always rolling without slipping. So here energy is not only just translational energy, it will also rotate. No, when a body is rotating, it will have rotational energy and forward moving energy, both of them together. So here kinetic energy will both be equal to half mv square plus half I omega square. And in this case, we can directly write half mv square plus half into m into I is nothing but mr square by 2, no, for this for disks it will be mr square by 2 into omega is v by r whole square. I'll directly simplify it here, which will get it as half mv square plus 1 by 4 mv square. So we know kinetic energy in both the cases will be 1 by 4 mv. The first equation, we know kinetic energy, no, potential energy we solve, that's all. Initially this is given velocity v1, this will be v2, and we'll directly write work energy theorem equation. Work energy theorem for first body. For first body, initially potential energy is m into g into 30, because it's at 30 meters from the ground. So I'm taking that way. Kinetic energy will be 3 by 4 into m into v square, v naught square. And finally, m into g into 0, and kinetic energy final will be, they have same linear speeds, I think, no, we don't know what that is, 3 by 4 mv. Applying both, we'll get m into g into 30 is equal to 3 by 4 into m into v square minus, cancelling out this, we are getting v square minus 3 square is equal to 440 g. Second equation, what do we get? Work energy theorem in the second equation. Initially, u will be m into g into 27, because the height is 27 meters from the ground, CD. It is coming down with that much height, so you can get it. Kinetic energy initially will be 3 by 4 into m into 7 square. And finally, u finally is 0. Kinetic energy final will be 3 by 4. Now I equate both of them again. M into g into 27 minus 3 by 4 m into v 7 square equal to 3 by 4 into m into, directly from this we'll get v square, again m and m are getting cancelled. So, and also 3, 3 and 9s are getting cancelled. So v square minus 7 square is equal to 36 g. From these both we get it. Have to find the velocity, not 7, but the answer is. So we'll observe the careful equation. Initially potential energy is m into g into 27, the kinetic energy is 3 by 4 mu square, whatever u is, or v2, we'll just call it v2, and finally both will have same speed, so I put 3 by 4 mv square, getting it. So v square minus u square is equal to 36 g, v square minus 3 square is 40 g. So directly subtracting 1 minus 2. Yes, exactly. I wrote off the answer because I calculated it directly just now. My bad. So we'll directly equate both of them. V square minus 3 square is equal to 400. V square minus u square is equal to v2 square is equal to subtracting it, no, we'll get v2 square minus v square is equal to 360, taking g as 10. Cancel these both. U2 square minus 3 square is equal to 40. V2 square is equal to 49. V is equal to 7. Got it. So 7 is the right answer. Next. So we are almost done. We have to do a few more problems, but let me finish this first and we'll call it off for today, because we can't take more than 2 hours. You also need a break. Okay. Good one, Sim24. Very good. Jay Joker Baba. A nuclear power plant supplying electrical power to a village uses radioactive material of half-life T years. So every T years, the amount of fuel will become half. The amount of fuel at the beginning in such a total power requirement is 12.5% of the electrical power available from the plant at that time. So initially the power, whatever it is, it's only P by 8. 12.5% means P by 8. Only P by 8 is being used by village. Initially. So if the plant is able to meet the total power needs of the village for maximum period of NT, then the value of N is. It's a very simple question. Initially P will be P, and after T years, it will become P by 2, right? Because the number of molecules will become P by 2. Now after another T years, it will become P by 4, because half of this. After another T years, it will become P by 8. Directly by seeing, you can say. So from beginning till the end, it is taking total time of 3 T years. Directly, the value of n will be getting it. There is no need to think big about this. It's a very simple question. 12.5% of the electric power available at the time, if the plant is able to meet the total power needs of the village for a maximum period of NT years, the value of n will be 3. It is straightforward. Next, two stars A and B emit black body radiation. What is the energy power radiated? Power is proportional to E A T power 4, no? Power will be equal to E into A into T power 4. We know this formula, right? We'll have to use this only here. What is A? A is area of cross section, T is temperature. Now radius of A is 400 times that of radius of B. And A emits 10 power 4 times power of B. Okay. The ratio of lambda A by lambda B, where lambda A and lambda B are the temperatures, are the wavelengths at which peak occurs in radiation curve. This you have to use lambda M into T is equal to B. Remember this. This is another formula. Lambda is the wavelength into temperature will be constant. Okay. This constant also will be equal to 2.88 into 10 power minus 3 centimeters. So this, I forgot the name of this, but this is a very important thing. It is also very important for your board exams. It's a very important question. Remember that lambda M into T is constant. So we know power ratio, we know RA ratio. Do you want to use emittivity and all? No, we'll just use area and temperature. P1 by P2 is equal to A1 by A2 into T1 power 4 by T2 power 4. Stefan Boltzmann's law, yeah, something like that, yeah. Boltzmann, the mad guy, you know that, no? Okay, so P1 by P2 is equal to A1 by 8 into T1 power 4 by T2 power. Now, what is A? Area is nothing but 4 pi R square, no? So, I will directly write A is proportional to R square. So, directly we now will get P1 by P2 equal to R1 square by R2 square into T1 power 4 by T2 power 4. Now substitute the values here directly. Power 1 by power 2 is 10 power 4. It will be equal to 400 square to T1 power 4 by T2 power 4. Now just to make it simple, this here there is 10 power 4, no? Here only there is square, everywhere else there is 4. So what I will do is I will write 400 as 20 square. Now what will this become? 20 square whole square. So this will now become 10 power 4 is equal to 20 power 4 into T1 power 4 by T2 power 4. From this directly I will get T1 by T2 is equal to 1 by 2. Wow, such simple method. Now we know lambda into T is constant, which implies lambda 1 by lambda 2 will be equal to T2 by T1 is equal to 2. End of question. Got it? So this is how it is. It's pretty easy. This question, just see it and you will get the answer. Okay. A bullet is fired vertically upward with V from the surface of the spherical planet. When it reaches maximum height, its acceleration due to planet's gravity is 1/4 of its value at the surface of the planet. So on the surface, its gravity is whatever, G. At this particular height, here the acceleration due to gravity is G by 4. Okay. If the escape velocity is V, V escape is V root n, the value of n. Now here the kinetic energy is half mv square. Here kinetic energy is 0, but there will be potential energy. So let's start solving this question. This is the last one. We'll call it off after this. Okay. Next. So initially we know what is G at the height H equal to? G into M by R square, no? Whatever X square. So simply we can, wait, let me write. You know how field works? At surface is equal to G M by R square. And at any distance, it will be gm by x square when x is greater than r. It's outside the surface, you can use this formula. And this is coming out to be gm by r square into 1 by 4, no? So, cancelling out the whole thing, we will directly get from here that x is equal to 2r. So, the particle is going from the ground to a height of 2r from the center. If you throw from here, it is going up to 2r from the center, which means it is at r from the ground. First thing we got. Now we will use conservation of energy. Initial potential energy is minus gmm by r plus initial kinetic energy is half mv square. And finally, potential energy will be how much? Minus gmm by x, which is equal to minus gmm by 2r. Kinetic energy is 0. Equating both of them, what will you get? Half mv square minus gmm by 2r is equal to minus gmm by 4r, right? Equating both, we will directly get off half mv square is equal to gmm by 4r, which means, gmm by r and 2r. Directly subtracting those both, you will get v. From this, we will get v is equal to root gm by r. Now, what is escape velocity? You know, escape velocity is root 2gm by r, no? Orbital velocity is root gm by r and escape velocity is root 2gm by r. From these both, directly we can write out that v escape is equal to root 2 into v, where the value of n is equal to 2. Got it? So, this paragraph will take some time. It's a very lengthy problem. So, I will do this paragraph tomorrow. It's a very interesting paragraph. So, thank you all for being such nice viewers, and any doubts you have, you feel free to ask anything about anything in life, not just problem solving or just 2020. So, thank you guys. I want you all to like, share and subscribe and hit the bell icon, because I will take this on a regular basis. Good job, Sim. 2 is the correct answer. I will keep doing it every day, and after this problems are over, I will teach topics also. We can define our strategy based on mains or advanced. We will do both of them. So, do not forget, install the Unacademy learning app right away, because I will be giving special classes about how you should go about it for the next 4 months or 5 months. And I will give you strategies for cracking 2021 without just physics and chemistry and maths. I am not going to teach physics, chemistry, maths in the class. So, install it right away. Use my code NHS1 to avail additional 10% off. NHS1 is very important for you guys. Extra 10% off. Yes, by the way, it's time for IPL today. I am an SRH fan, as I just told you in the beginning. Jay Sunrisers, Jay Orange Army, can't wait for it. So, have fun, you guys. Yesterday was a very interesting match, and I'm teaching class early because you can revise what I taught you, and then you can just see a little of the match also, because my approach has always been different. It is not about working hard. Okay, I will explain this again. It is not about working hard. It is about working the right amount. You sit and study for the entire time, you will lose your brain will become weak. It will not be able to think much. You will lose energy. So I want you guys to relax also from time to time. Work hard for 2 hours, then relax for half an hour or 40 minutes. Then work hard again for 2 hours. That is when your brain will be ready to catch it. Understood? So see you tomorrow. Until then, let's see the match today. We'll discuss about it tomorrow. But yesterday's match was very good. We'll discuss it as we go. Chalo. Adios amigos. Until next time.